was a part of a neoliberal agenda and theory, meaning that, thank you, meaning that the government, the liberal policies of going back to Franklin Roosevelt, of social concern about the masses of people and so forth, are no longer going to be viable because the government has nothing to do with why you're not succeeding in a country where there's no problems, and you, this is a country of opportunity. If you just really work hard, you'll get it. And this allows the government to pump money into the military and nothing into social programs and so forth and so on. So this is a, sort of the neoliberal agenda. And so part of that is this, that the ongoing racism that is perpetrated against black people has nothing to do with 250 years of slavery and 100 or more years of oppression and Jim Crow behaviors that where we struggle just to survive even up to today. And so the idea is that there's nothing wrong with America, now there's something wrong with you. Maybe you've made bad personal choices. This was a theme that Obama himself reiterated over and over at the NAACP meetings and Howard University and so forth, saying we have to get these black men home and stop, they have to be better fathers. What's wrong with you? As though there's no such thing as poverty in America, no such thing as not getting and being able to get a job, especially if you're formerly incarcerated. That's the group that's the nonprofit that I work with trying to get businesses for formerly incarcerated people. And so this idea is that there's something wrong with black men, that they're making bad choices, you know, sagging pants, wearing the grill. I don't know if they wear grill anymore. But anyway, as though if they just lift up your pants and take off the grill, we're going to be free any minute now. And then there's even the thought that maybe there's something is really wrong with this, maybe some sort of a genetic problem. You know, like they, you know, people say, well, the Vietnamese come here and they do well, and the Koreans come here and they do well. Even Africans from Africa, we never know what country they're from, we just say African. Well, Africans will come here and they do well. What's wrong with black people in America? And we say that, don't we? Why haven't we got more businesses? Are we trifling, lazy, don't have good education because we're stupid, simple-minded, and backwards? So we ask the same question. Mm. So that's the new age racism, where it's like personal choices and things that you could have done, you didn't do, because everything is really available to you now. Ever since the 64 Civil Rights Act and the 65 Voting Rights Act, you have nothing to complain about, black people. Mm. What are you complaining about? So if you don't have anything, it's because there's something wrong with black people. This is the new age racist agenda that was put into full place in the 1990s with the election of Bill Clinton. And with, as I said, with the arrest and trial of a young brother here in Atlanta named Little B. So I want to tell you something about Little B, whose name is Michael Lewis. He was 8 years old when he discovered that his house had become the crack house, and his mother was crack addicted. And he grew up, as I say, here in Atlanta, if you call it growing up, in an area that many of you may be familiar with called the Bluff. Mm-hmm. Not far from here, is it? Mm-mm. Still doing some of the same business that it was doing back in that day, 1997. In the Bluff, their only commerce was drugs. You could buy ecstasy, you could buy crack cocaine, powder cocaine, weed, hydroponic weed, whatever you wanted, purple, you could buy it, but you couldn't buy any fresh vegetables. I keep trying to tell people there's a Bluff in every city in America where black people are, isn't there? We all know that it's there. We act like we, some of us pretend we don't know, except when we want to sneak over there and get some dope. But other than that, let's not lie, because my daughter will tell you about her friends and colleagues that used to jump over to the Bluff all the time. Some of them get hurt over there messing around in the wrong areas. But anyway, the Bluff had nothing there but drugs, and so this was a boy who grew up in this environment. I always tell people, you know, you cannot be a vegan in the Bluff. You would just be a dead Negro, because if you're looking for some fresh vegetables and some kind of way not to eat bad food, it won't be in the Bluff or any other Bluff, and, you know, whether it's the west side of Chicago, North Philadelphia, what have you, that still exists where black people haven't been dispersed to the hinterlands by gentrification. You could see the Georgia Dome, or the new Georgia Dome, going up now, but at that time you could see the Georgia Dome from the Bluff, but you didn't have any, that was another land, it had nothing to do with you. You were down there living like that. Michael was 8 years old when he discovered his house was the crack house, and the only parent to him by this time was his older brother, who was a fledgling dope boy. And Michael became a parent to his younger sister. By the time she was 5 and he was 8, he was washing her clothes and taking them to school so they could get free breakfast and free lunch. I always like to say thanks to the Black Panther Party, right?
I know.
By the time he was 11, he had gone to a couple of group homes or foster homes, one in which he was severely abused. And so by the time he was declared deprived by the court after several hearings over the years, at 11 years old, he just decided he was going to do the only thing he knew how to do, stay on the street, stay out of school, and just start working with his brother and dealing dope, slinging a little bit. And so he started selling dope, and that's how he survived. And when people talk about genius, you know, I was just talking to people today about, the SAT and the LSAT and how we have this illusion that they actually measure some form of intellect. When, I always say I could teach my dog Spot to pass the SAT with a couple of biscuits, give me a couple of months. Come on, Spot, just hit one of these. It's going to all work out, because that's how worthless the whole thing is. And first, it doesn't measure anything except for how much money you spend on taking the SAT test, taking the course. It certainly doesn't measure anything about Black people or white people, as the bell curve once promulgated, and we still have that in our head. And so this was a boy who didn't go back to school after 11 years old, but you had to be really a genius to live on the streets by yourself at 11 and figure out. I asked him, I said, well, what did you do? Where did you live? I mean, you didn't have any place to live. You were homeless. He said, no, I was never homeless. I could always find some place to stay. You know how people couch surf. We call it couch surfing. People know about couch surfing here in Atlanta. People don't really have a place to live. And it's a lot of young people like that. But this was the age of crack cocaine, right? I mean, when I grew up, nobody was on crack, and there's a reason for that. And there was no crack. There was no cocaine. Cocaine, even later on, as it came into existence in the United States, was a drug of the rich and famous. It was a Hollywood drug for anybody who had a little bit of money to get drugs in the early 70s, late 60s. And then eventually there was this tremendous influx of cocaine, which flipped into crack, just another form of cocaine, cooked and so forth. So how did that happen? We haven't had a boat since Marcus Garvey, and that Black Star Line never sailed. We know we didn't go to Bolivia and Colombia and Peru to get any cocaine. So how did it land in Atlanta or Philadelphia and all these different? How did all these drugs get into our communities? And so then people start responding, and this is the New Age racist response, like Nancy Reagan. Well, you could have just said no, And so there was this proliferation of drugs, and we now know, if nothing is evidence, in a book by a man named Gary Webb, who was a journalist for the San Jose Mercury News in California, and Webb wrote a book called Dark Alliance, based on a series of articles that he'd written about the connection between the CIA dumping drugs into the Black community in order to get funding for a group called the Contras. You remember the Iran-Contra conflict or situation, Oliver North and so forth. If you don't, then you need to read about it, because that has a lot to do with how Black people ended up with so many drugs in our community. And we are poor. If I'm Dante, and all I can do is get a job at McDonald's for $5 an hour, which I don't want, if it was $15 an hour, but I don't want to work at McDonald's anyway, but I can get a job at McDonald's for $5 an hour, but I can sling some dope for $5,000, I might make $5,000 a day. I don't know that that's going to be a difficult choice for me to make. And if that means I have to be ruthless like the rest of the capitalists in America, like Wall Street, I've learned a lot from Wall Street, or the Mafia and all those other people that become ruthless and greedy and so forth and so on. So as a